Good evening. You're watching The Digital Age, and I'm James Goodale. Everyone knows that newspapers are having a very bad time. They're losing money. They're losing circulation. What can be done? The big debate in the newspaper world today is whether you can make up for the losses that you are suffering elsewhere and make up for them on the net. How do you do that? You make people pay on the net. But will people pay on the net? Why would people pay for something they get for free? Here to discuss that question tonight is Gordon Crovitz, who has an impeccable credential of being the former publisher of the Wall Street Journal, where he oversaw the paid website for the Wall Street Journal, and is now a partner in journalism online with Steve Brill, who is a man with a particular and wonderful reputation, who is your partner.
Absolutely.
Brill's been in many startup ventures. Without going into great detail, basically, you've got an idea that you can make these newspapers that are having a hard time, make people pay for websites through a PayPal type of system. Is that right?
The idea really is that newspapers have always relied on circulation revenue as well as advertising revenue in the print world. And we think there's really no reason why they can't do the same online. There are several newspapers and other kinds of news sites, online-only news sites, that have done a very good job creating enough value for people to say, I can't get that kind of information for free anyplace. I value it enough to pay for it online, just like historically we all did in print.
Well, can we take a look at what people think of the general idea? You have a particular idea, but the general idea of paying for news online, and particularly some of the response to your ideas, goes something like this. I'm going to read you a quote. Almost all internet professionals, on the other hand, think that charging for general interest news online is fanciful, rubbish, bonkers, a crock, a form of madness. That's the description of Emily Ball, who has long run the Guardian newspaper's website. That's a big paper in the UK. And the impeccable source for that statement, ultimately, is Michael Wolfe of Vanity Fair, and a recent article in which he really picks on Rupert Murdoch, who has almost the same idea that you have. Do you wish to respond, Mr. Crovitz?
Absolutely. Historically, the debate was really quite shallow, which was, will websites be free or will they be paid? Will they get all their revenue from advertising or all their revenue from circulation? The right answer is the freemium model, which is to have perhaps 90% of the visitors to most websites, including news websites, continue to get access for free. That 90% of the people don't necessarily value that brand or that content enough to pay for it. And when people say people will not pay for general news, if what they mean by that is commoditized news, sports scores, stock prices, general news, of course nobody will pay for that. It's available for free everywhere. It's ubiquitous. No, nobody's going to pay for something they can get for free. The issue is, for brands like The Guardian and many, many others, they have a deeply engaged audience. It may be 10% of their online readers, not 90%, maybe 10%, for whom full access to that brand and all that it stands for, they will decide is worth paying for, but only with one condition. They have to be asked.
They have to be asked to pay?
They have to be asked to pay. They have to be asked to pay, and the editors of those sites have got to deliver enough value so that consumers say, this, for me, is worth paying for.
Well, two important points there at the end. But someone's going to ask me to pay? Who is that going to be, you? You're going to come on my computer screen and say, pay?
I think the future of the web, whether it's at news websites or other publisher sites or through Google Search or Google News, the future of the web is going to be a lot more requests to be authorized. In other words, to pay for certain levels of access. The Financial Times model is quite interesting in this regard.
What is the Financial Times, first of all?
The Financial Times is a
you know, U.S. viewers?
Sure, it's a global London-based financial news franchise. It has a newspaper and, of course, a website, FT.com. And the FT's model is aimed at addressing this freemium idea, which is to say that not everybody is going to value that brand or the content enough to pay for it. Their model is people get 10 articles a month that they can read for free.
10 a month?
10 a month.
That's not very many.
And then after 10 essentially the message is, we're glad you enjoy this news site. We're glad you value it. Here are the reasons to become a subscriber so that you don't run into this paywall again. It has, for the Financial Times, delivered a lot of incremental revenues and profits, as it has for the Wall Street Journal, many others.
You know, we really ought to ask you, give you a fair chance here before we pick on you some more, to talk about the Wall Street Journal, which I'll refresh the audience's recollection, if any, is that in order to get the Wall Street Journal online, this statement may not be true, correct me, generally speaking, you have to pay, don't you, period, end? I mean, what's the answer?
So there are about a million people around the world who have subscribed to the Wall Street Journal's website. The number of people who read Wall Street Journal content on the web every month, I think the last reported number was about 20 million. So of the people reading the Wall Street Journal,
that's 20 different people. In other words, the Wall Street Journal has a circulation, say, of 2 million.
In print. That's right.
But you're telling me 20 million people watch the website?
Read Wall Street Journal articles on an average month. That's the latest public figure. So what that means is that there are a lot of people, about a million people, who value it enough to want to get full access. Then there are others who see the occasional article, who are sampling the journal or other news sites that have this model, and who over time may say, you know, this is really a great site. I don't want to miss anything from this site. I want the full experience and the full access to this site, and we become paying subscribers. We see this model in a lot of other areas. ConsumerReports.org, to take it a little bit outside of newspapers, has got, I think, about 3 million people around the world who subscribe to the website. There's a lot of free content at ConsumerReports.org also, but to get all the access to that site, you have to pay. It's a little bit like hanging out at a newsstand and flipping through a newspaper. You can stand at a newsstand and flip through a newspaper if you want to. Most people find it more convenient to pay a reasonable amount to get full access, carry it around, take it where they want to take it. So part of the misunderstanding, if I could put it that way, is that we, anyway, are not urging news sites to put up a giant paywall and cut off all their traffic, because we think for the average site, maybe 10% of the people will want full access. The others should continue to get access and to be monetized, to use that ugly verb, through advertising. Let the publisher take those page views, sell ads against it, make a little bit of money off it, but also have a second revenue stream for the most engaged users, which is a subscription revenue stream, which, by the way, from a business point of view, has a very high profit margin.
By that you mean when I pay to go on the web, it isn't any extra expense, it's just money just flows. And that's why Wall Street Journal was sold for so many billions, because of that site. Except that when Murdoch came on, he said, I think I want to switch this to free. And then he said, but I've done the math, this is later, and it seems to me it doesn't make any difference whether it's for free or for pay. Was he right about that? I guess not, right?
Well, I believe the News Corp strategy is very focused on the paid model.
Well, now it is. That supports your case. But isn't the key to all of this, all of you, all of pay, is that what the reader seeks has to be very unique, very different, and to pick up on a word you just said, not readily available elsewhere, not replaceable, irreplaceable? So if I tell you a little story about you, I read your columns online, and I got a Well, I should say you do have a column, by the way, and it's called The Digital Age.
The Information Age.
Oh, The Information Age.
Yes, Digital Age was taken by some TV show.
TV show. Anyway, so I read all these columns, and I had the ambition, well, here's a chance to read them all. I read The Wall Street Journal. Sometimes I don't read all the columns or read whatever, so I had a chance for me to catch up. So I'm going along. I read 10. Then it says, if you want to read any more of Mr. Crovitz's columns, you have to pay. Guess what? I didn't pay. Now, what does that tell you?
Well, it tells me a couple of things. One, the Wall Street Journal for many years has made the opinion columns and the opinion articles available for free. And my calculation when I was responsible for the P&L of the Wall Street Journal's website was that people probably would not pay to access opinion columns the way they might for some other content. And we've seen some experiments on the web where I think that turned out largely to be accurate. A lot of news sites charge for archives, for historic access to articles.
So I couldn't get your historical columns.
Well, you have now been frustrated once. I suspect when you're frustrated two or three times,
I'll pay a reasonable amount
to get the archive.
That's a good segue into the second point I want to discuss with you. Can I read you yet another quote? And this is directed to the question of whether once you're getting it free, you will pay, which is more or less what you were. Will you pay, which is more or less the question you posed. Here we go. You go behind a firewall and you take an audience haircut immediately, said Joe Gillespie, executive VP CBS of Interactive News and Technology. Quotes, you can really hurt search engine optimization. That means what he's saying is, if you convert me to getting the Crovitz's columns free to paying for Crovitz, I ain't going to do it, okay? And so that means my search engine loses me as a customer. Your response.
So again, the model is not put up a paywall, do not cut off Google from indexing the site. The model is encourage Google to index the site, have the results come up, in Google results being results, other search results, and then try a number of different techniques to persuade readers that there is something there of value. It could be 10 articles a month. It could be 30 articles a month. It could be for a local news site, newspaper, broadcast site, whatever it might be. It could be the high school sports, some of which is behind a paywall. It depends so much on each brand and the kind of content and the alternative sources for that kind of information. So we are not advocating put up a giant paywall, lose all your traffic. What we're advocating is maintain all the traffic you can possibly need for advertising purposes while generating subscription revenues from your 10% most engaged audience who want to get full access to that particular site, whether it's for access to the full site, like the Financial Times' model, access to particular areas of content, high school sports, local government, local schools, whatever the topic might be. And the challenge then becomes, for publishers, what I think the challenge by now should have become, which is, what does every news brand stand for at its core? What does it deliver to an audience that they can't get some other way? And at the end of the day, what is valuable enough that people will pay to access it? It's the most promising new revenue stream for news sites of all kinds, newspapers, magazines, online-only sites, bloggers. And as we work with our 1,100 or so publishing affiliates, those are our sites that are working with us to help determine what their go-to-market strategy might be. What we're finding is that virtually every brand, every news site, every publishing site has got a part of its audience that is deeply engaged, comes all the time, spends a lot of time on that site, and it also has more casual visitors. The challenge is, let the casual visitors continue to access the site for free, monetize them through advertising, sell advertising against those page views. But for the most engaged, find out what they value the most, charge them for it, and by the way, over time, allocate more and more resources, news resources, to creating original, distinguished, distinctive, unique content to increase the number of people who say, I really like that site. I can't live without that site. It's worth paying a reasonable amount because there's something there that I can't get anyplace else.
Well, that's a fascinating response because there's so many diamonds for me to discover in that answer. The last one I want to pick up on. Now, what you said is, we've got these sites. We've got and by the way, it doesn't have to be a newspaper site. Although you did start by saying you've got clients, most of whom are newspapers, are they not?
Of our 1,100, most are newspapers, but they're magazines, a lot of online sites.
But it doesn't have to be newspapers.
Absolutely.
It could be, so you, first of all, you say it can be anyone who's got a print model. And then you say, secondly,
I'm sorry, Jim, anybody who's got an online model,
excuse me. See, I'm the old media, what can I do? It slips right out. But so anyway, I'm going on to this website, say the Boston Globe that I've gone on for years. And you're going to find out I've been on there all the time. But now here's the interesting thing you tell me. You're going to tell me if I'm wrong about this, but this sounds like Steve Brill and Gordon Crovitz, if I've ever heard it before. You're going to tell the Boston Globe not only that I'm coming on all the time, but they're going to have to change their content on the web to make it so unique that once I go to that site and I have to pay, I just gotta, because it's so sensational. So this is a takeover of the whole online world. Not really, but you get my point.
No, I think there's an immediate opportunity and a long-term opportunity. Right. The immediate opportunity is that the Boston Globe and many, 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 many other sites have got, among their monthly visitors, on average, 10% who value the current offerings enough to be willing to pay to get full access.
Okay, so that's a two-part answer.
And 10% of the unique visitors, the monthly visitors, to a lot of websites is a huge number. And if they have enough value to get $50, $60, $70, $80 a year for a subscription, could be a very significant source of improvement to an industry that is desperately looking for new sources of revenue. The longer term opportunity is, for example, for the Boston Globe to work with other publishers to create a Boston Red Sox package for people who are Red Sox fans, and to create a package that would appear on the Boston Globe they might charge extra for, and Red Sox fans might be very happy to get access to that other content that might also otherwise require a payment. So we think there's a lot, in the longer term, a lot of opportunity for editors and publishers to think about how people use the web to collect content from other sources, present it on their websites, and to do that in a way that helps consumers by helping them find information, stories, content, whatever it might be, that they otherwise would have to go around the web finding for themselves.
Well, let's take the Boston Globe as an example, which can be repeated newspaper by newspaper, majority of your clients, countrywide. Okay, I go on. I've been getting this stuff free, right? And then there I get to this point where I can't get it. Why don't I just go on, as they say in New England, to the next pew? That is to say, go on to the next website. Or why don't I say to myself, the hell with it? Because, look, I can listen to the best news station in Boston, let's say it's WBZ or something like that. I can listen to online radio. I can go to Google News, and you know, they can hide the ball from me on that stuff, but guess what? I don't care. And by the way, Boston Globe circulation is interesting because it's had one of the steeper drops in the country. And a lot of people think it's because the online IQ of everybody in Boston, being smart students, so forth and so on, is so high. The hell with it. You know, it's news is, it's another bad word, a commodity. You know, you can get it anywhere, you've got it. The hell with you, Crovitz.
Yeah. So a couple things. We're going to find out as more and more news sites launch this kind of freemium approach, where they try to find a value proposition for that minority of their visitors online to convert them to paying subscribers. I think what we will find is throughout the world, and we have affiliates from five continents now, that news brands have a core essence. They have journalism that is not available someplace else. It's not going to be AP stories, let's be clear. It's not going to be sports scores. It's not going to be commoditized news. It's going to have to be some content, some journalism, that's very distinctive, not available someplace else. But don't sell these brands quite so short.
Okay.
The longer term opportunity is for news sites to understand they have a lot of visitors from outside their physical distribution area if they're a newspaper. How many of the people going to the Boston Globe site, to take that example, are people who used to live in Boston who really don't have another great source of news about Boston? People are reading The Guardian. Most of them are outside the UK. They can't get the physical newspaper. Why should The Guardian have the exact same model for inside the UK as outside the UK? And there are many precedents for this freemium approach. Take NPR radio. NPR radio stations don't think of themselves as being in the paid content business, but they do aspire to get about 10% of their active listeners to be supporters, to be members of local radio stations. And this same freemium approach, people who are deeply engaged, who value the service, in the case of for-profit publishing sites, it's not going to be charitable, but it is going to be people who are so deeply engaged, who want to get everything that site has to offer, who don't want to run into a paywall, who will be the ones who go from being free users to paid users, as has happened already with a number of publishing sites around the world.
Are these 10% people you talk about, are they high IQ, low IQ? What's their anybody?
They're people who value the content
of
and
that
the
particular
access.
So it could be anyone.
It could be somebody following high school sports. It could be somebody, in the case of consumerreports.org, who wants to buy a microwave that month. People have got an endless desire for information. So Stuart Brand, the great guru, once said, information wants to be free. And people remember that. What they forget is, he then said, information also wants to be expensive. By which he meant, in an electronic, digital, now internet age, access to the right information at the right time, in the right context, is worth a lot to all of us.
Let me give you a fair chance. You're going to provide these sites with a new technology, and you've got, how many did you say, signed up? All these people signed up. Mm-hmm. And you deliver this technology, and it's going to be like PayPal, so it's going to be much easier for people to pay. Is that the idea?
So, sure. The idea is that on the web, people will have a universal account. People will be able to use our account to access many, many websites around the world. This means that if they already subscribe to one site, that adding a second site or a third or a fourth will be very easy. They won't have to take out their credit card, go through the
right.
whole
And so this is the, this is the real key. I haven't given you a fair chance to describe your idea, but the real idea here, other than the 10%, well, not the real idea, but a very important idea, is the technology idea, because you're going to deliver to the Boston Globe a system where you don't get upset. Almost said something else. Get upset every time you're asked to sign on and pay. What does that apply to every newspaper, say? In other words, if I sign up once with you, and then I go not to the Boston Globe, but I go to the San Diego Union, I go right on the San Diego Union?
If somebody already has an account through us, then they'll be able to access other brands very easily with a couple of clicks of the mouse.
Couple of clicks, that's all? I don't have to sign in again? Do I have to use my password?
Well, we'll want to be sure that people want to add a new subscription, but it'll be a very simple process. And the idea here really is we understand that on the web, this is a transition from almost entirely free to mostly free. And to make that transition as simple, convenient, frictionless as possible for people on the web, we think it'll be a real advantage for them to have an account that makes it very easy for them to add access to other sites, as opposed to having to decide every time they get to a new site, do I want to go through the rigmarole of taking out my credit card and inputting the information and going through and having multiple subscription points rather than having one account at one place, where, by the way, we also hope over time to be able to offer not just access to the web edition, but also to the iPhone app or the BlackBerry edition or the e-reader edition, so that the relationship will be between the publisher and the reader will be offered access to that brand across multiple channels, not just the web, but also mobile devices and e-readers and whatever else comes along later.
Well, this secret technology, when's it going to be unveiled? Where is it? Can you tell me anything about it, or will you give everything away?
We have a number of beta customers and our
beta customers.
These are early customers.
Early customers
who will be working with our technology later in the fall.
Later in the fall, and when are you going to release the list of your newspapers or your magazines?
Yeah,
a number of our
affiliates, as we call them, about 1,100 around the world, have themselves announced their plans to move toward this paid model and their involvement with us. And they will make their own announcements about their approach to the market. And, you know, the platform that we're offering them gives them a lot of choices about what they might charge for. And I think different news sites will charge differently, and they'll make their own announcements about that.
We've come to an end. Will people pay for what they get free? Yes or no, Gordon Crovitz?
People will pay for what they can't otherwise get if it's of enough value to them that it's worth paying for. Keep in mind, around the world, people spend about $25 billion to access news and information through the old analog medium called print. People are willing to pay to get really good content. And they'll do it online just as they have in print.
Was that a yes or no answer?
Yes. Yes, they will.
Thanks for coming by, Gordon.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for coming by. Come by next week and learn more about the information age. That's the title of Gordon Crovitz's column. We call ourselves the digital age. And learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night and have a good week.